Yeah, please proceed.
Dr. Soumya, please start the share the screen as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, yes, yes, yes. I'm just doing that. Is it visible to everyone?
Yes.
Yeah, yes.
Dr. Chitti, continue. Tripti? Dr. Tripti?
Dr. Tripti, please unmute
Hello?
Yourself.
Yeah,
Hello?
Yes, yes, please speak again. You have been okay. Muted till now. Yeah. Thank
okay.
You.
Please, Dr. Shivram, sir, I request, please say a few words about the Young Professional Forum. Dr. Shivram, sir.
I can only say I'm very happy to be invited to this Young Professional Forum. And I'm very glad I've gone through the slides of Dr. Deepika, and she has lined up an interesting array of slides ranging from some simple cases to very challenging cases. I hope to have a very nice session with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I would like to introduce Dr. Sunita, ma'am. She is our another chairperson. It's my honor to introduce her. She is 30 years experience as a faculty in transfusion medicine. She completed various projects with WHO, NACO, and ICMR. She is principal investigator for plasma therapy, clinical trial for COVID-19, PLACID trial by ICMR. She also is examiner for MBBS, MD, diploma in IHBT students for various universities in India. She published 25 research papers in various national and international journals. Please, ma'am, say a few words about Young Professional Forum. Dr. Sunita, ma'am.
Ma'am, please unmute yourself. Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I thank you, everyone, for inviting me for such a nice talk. I am very pleased to be here and hear your talk. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I hand over to Dr. Soumya for introduction of Dr. Deepika for further process of further for seminar. Dr. Soumya?
Yes. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Dr. Deepika. She is currently working as assistant professor in Department of Immunohematology and Blood Transfusion at Kasturba Medical College, Manipal. Her key areas of interest are immunohematology, apheresis technology and cellular therapy, clinical hemotherapy and blood donor recruitment and retention. She is also the reviewer of Global Journal of Transfusion Medicine, of ABB and Turkish Journal of Hematology. She had been awarded with, received the Indian Society of Transfusion Medicine Postgraduate Student Award in the year 2014. To her credit, she has 17 national and international journals, articles published in index journals. And she is also the member of the national body that is ISTM and the international body as ABB. She is also a member of the Indian Society of Transfusion Medicine Special Interest Group of the Immunohematology. Over to you, Dr. Deepika, to hear the presentation on ABO discrepancies case-based approach.
Thank you, Dr. Soumya, for that introduction.
I'll just stop sharing the screen. Just
yes. So I'm audible, right?
Just 1 second before Deepika, you start. We would like you to post your questions on the chat box. We can take the questions at the end of the session. And the other thing is we will shortly post the link for the webinar certificate. So kindly fill it out and by which you'll be receiving the certificate at the end of the session. Over to Dr. Deepika. Thank you. Deepika, please share your screen.
Yes, yes,
Deepika.
1 minute.
Yeah.
Is it visible?
Yeah, it's visible.
Thank you, Dr. Soumya. First of all, I would like to thank the team YPF for giving me this opportunity. And I also would like to thank our chairpersons of the day, Dr. Shivram and Dr. Sunita, for chairing this session. So today's topic is on ABO discrepancies, the case-based approach. So I'll be taking a brief introduction and followed by the cases and a summary of the discrepancies and the resolution. So all of us know, we are grateful to our Dr. Karl Landsteiner, the Austrian physician who discovered the first three human blood groups and paved the way for the safe transfusion practices. And for this discovery, he has been awarded the Nobel Prize for Medicine in 1930. And to date, we have 38 blood group systems being identified and with more than 300 blood group antigens, which are expressed all over the RBC red cell surface. And the ABO and RH are considered the major blood group systems, followed by MNS, KEL, Duffy, KID as the minor blood group systems. And the uniqueness of this ABO blood group system is that all the individuals have antibodies to the antigens that are absent from their RBCs without any previous exposure through pregnancy or transfusions. So these are expected isoagglutinins, which are seen in the serum of the individuals. In other words, they are naturally occurring, which are produced upon exposure to environmental sources like the pollen, fungus, or the bacteria, which have structure similar to the RBC antigens. So as per the Landsteiner's law, if an individual has an A antigen, he is expected to have an anti-B in his plasma. And the B antigen, if it is present, expected anti-A in his plasma. And when there are both A and B antigens on the red cell surface, no antibodies are expected. And when there is neither A nor B antigens on the red cell surface, both the anti-A and anti-B are to be expected in the plasma. So this forms the basis for our regular blood grouping interpretation and reporting. So if we have to see the cell grouping, also called the forward grouping, which helps in detection of the A or B antigens present on the red cell surface using the commercially available antisera. And the serum grouping, also called the reverse grouping, which helps in the detection of the A or B isoagglutinins using known reagent RBCs. So each serves as a check over the other. And any mismatch between the cell and the serum grouping leads to a discrepancy. And this discrepancy has to be resolved before reporting and interpretation of the final blood group, because these ABO isoagglutinins are of IgM type, which can activate complement and can lead to hemolysis, leading to an untoward hemolytic transfusion reaction in an individual. So before interpretation, if there is a discrepancy, if there is a need for transfusion, the patient should be considered group O red cells to be transfused, and the donor unit should be quarantined until the discrepancy is resolved. With this brief background, let us move on to the case-based learning. And since antibody discrepancies or the serum discrepancies are more commonly seen, we will first discuss this serum grouping discrepancies, their resolution techniques, followed by the cell grouping discrepancies. So to start with, it was a 24-year-old male admitted with fracture femur, followed by a road traffic accident. We received a request for blood grouping and cross match, and the blood grouping report is as shown below by column agglutination technology. So his forward was A positive. And reverse, there was an unexpected reaction with the A cells. So the grouping was repeated in tube technique, which is considered to be the standard technology. And still, there is a unexpected weak reaction with the A cells. And when there was a cross match performed, it was incompatible with A cells. And when we reviewed the history, he had no history of transfusion or other causes. So what could be the possible causes of this unexpected reaction in the A cells? So the first thing what we could suspect is a subgroup of A with a anti-A1 or an unexpected antibody reacting with the antigens, which is present only on the A cells but not the O cells. So when we tried to resolve using A1 lectin, his cells were showing no reaction, and the reverse typing with A2 cells was negative. So this confirmed his blood group to be of A2 with anti-A1. And since the cross match was also incompatible, that means this anti-A1 is reacting at 37 degrees centigrade. So for transfusion support, it is he has to receive O or A2 phenotype rather than A1, which can lead to transfusion reaction. A small note on A1 and A2 phenotypes. Generally, A2 phenotypes are account to only 20% of the total A phenotypes. And of these 20%, only 1 to 8% of the A2 phenotype and around 5 to 10% of the A2B phenotype make the anti-A1. Generally, this anti-A1 is naturally occurring and cold reacting does not cause hemolysis at 37. But when it reacts at 37 degrees centigrade, it is better to avoid A1 unit transfusion for such individuals. They also differ both quantitatively and qualitatively. That is, the A2 phenotype has a less number of antigen sites, less amount of transferase enzymes, and less amount of branching as well. And qualitatively, they differ even in the precursor oligosaccharide chains, and there are even subtle differences in the transferase enzymes. So it is important to identify these individuals with anti-A1, and potent anti-A1 reacting at 37 degrees centigrade has to be noted with caution. Coming to the next case, it was a 59-year-old female received in trauma triage for spontaneous nosebleed. The samples were received for pre-transfusion testing in view of ongoing bleed. The technician reported a blood group discrepancy and a mixed field reaction in the antibodies screening and the cross match. So his in column agglutination technology, the forward group was B, B negative, and the reverse, there was an unexpected reaction with B cells and O cells. And you can see the mixed field reaction in the IAT as well. And in room, when we repeated the test in tube technique, there was a weaker reaction, but still the discrepancy persisted with the B cells and O cells. And at 37, the discrepancy resolved. So it could be a cold agglutinin causing the reverse grouping discrepancy. We even performed a DAT and it was negative. The anti-H and anti-AB were positive. So it could, the possible cause could be a cold autoantibody or an alloantibody, but since the DAT is negative, it could be an autoantibody. And when we reviewed the samples, we have noticed that there is a mucoid or gel-like appearance of the sample. So when we saw the clinical details, there was increased gamma globulins in this patient, and the M band is increased and cryoglobulins were present. So it was a case of Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, and these cold agglutinins were causing the discrepancy in the blood grouping and the IAT. So a pre-warming of the sample was done in this case, and repeat IAT was negative and the cross match was compatible. So coming to the next case, a 28-year-old female at 28 weeks of gestation has come for routine antenatal checkup. Her blood transfusion, the blood transfusion center received the samples for blood grouping, and the reports are as shown below. So the forward was A negative, and there is an unexpected reaction with A cells and O cells. So it was repeated in tube technique, and the reaction still persisted both at room temperature as well as at 37 degrees centigrade. And the anti-H and anti-AB are 4+. So the forward is a ARHD negative, it is clear, and the reverse is still A, but there is a presence of some irregular antibody. So we have also performed the antibody screening. Screening was positive and the DAT is negative in this case. So the possible cause could be a non-ABO isoagglutinin causing the discrepancy. So when we reviewed the history, the patient is of Gravida 1, Para 1 with one termination of pregnancy, and her history revealed that she has recently received anti-D immunization. So when we performed the identification to confirm, the antibody was identified to be anti-D. And to resolve this kind of discrepancies because of alloantibodies, we can use antigen negative cells. So in this case, use of Rh negative pooled cells will help in resolution of the discrepancy. So when negative pooled cells were used, the discrepancy was resolved and showing a clear A negative blood group. So moving on to the next case, it was a 34-year-old male posted for surgery for inguinal hernia. The blood group reports are as below. The forward was O positive and the reverse was pan reactive. So it could be a O with presence of an irregular antibody. So repeat testing in tube technique, still the discrepancy persisted, but anti-H showed a negative reaction and the anti-AB was negative. So the absence of H antigen in this case helps us in diagnosing that it could be a Pompe phenotype. So to confirm, the secretor studies were also performed. In this secretor studies, the saliva of the person contains the soluble ABH substances in general, and 80% of them are secretors. But in Bombay phenotype, they are classically non-secretors. So to test, the saliva is mixed with diluted reagent antisera. And when there is neutralization of these salivary substances, when the indicator cells are added, there will be a negative reaction. So absence of soluble substances will give a positive reaction, and presence of soluble substances will give a negative reaction. So in this case, there was a 2+ reaction with O cells after salivary testing, and he was confirmed to be a non-secretor for H substance. So we also formed the pedigree chart of this patient, trying to get the family donors, and we could identify that his sister was also of a Bombay phenotype. Though this patient did not require any transfusion, however, both of them were counseled about the rare phenotype, the blood group card was issued, and the importance of receiving only Bombay blood group red cells for transfusion. Since they were eligible donors, we have also requested them to be part of our rare donor registry for support of such kind of patients. Coming to the next case, a 52-year-old male posted for an elective total knee replacement surgery. The results of type and screen sent to the transfusion service is as below. The forward was O positive and the reverse was O with an irregular antibody showing a mixed field. So repeat testing in tube technique revealed the same type of discrepancy with a weaker reaction, and the anti-H lectin is positive and the anti-AB is negative. So it was similar to the previous case, but the grade of reaction is less and the anti-H is positive. So it could be an ORHD positive with the presence of an irregular antibody. So on reviewing the on performing antibody screening, it was 3+ reactive and the DAT was negative in this patient, and he had no history of transfusion or transplantation. When we performed the antibody identification, we could see the pattern of anti-M showing dosage, and we could conclude that it was a naturally occurring anti-M showing dosage and as well causing the discrepancy in the reverse grouping. So this anti-M was reacting both at room temperature as well as at 37 degrees centigrade. And so it is important to give M antigen negative units for the patient for transfusion. And use of M antigen negative pooled cells can also resolve the discrepancy in this case. Moving on to the next case. It is a 58-year-old male with grade 2 prostatomegaly posted for TURP surgery. We received a request for type and screen. The forward was A positive and the reverse grouping was pan reactive. And even the antibody screening was pan reactive, However, the DAT was negative in this case. So when we repeated the grouping at room temperature, there was a mild decrease in the reverse grouping discrepancy, but at 37 degrees centigrade, the A cells and O cells showed a negative reaction with an expected positive reaction in the B cells. However, the reaction with anti-H was only weak and the anti-AB is 4+. So the forward is A positive in this case and the reverse is also A, but still the screening, antibody screening is pan-reactive. And the patient had no history of transfusion as well. So with this, we were thinking of the possible causes of, could it be an antibody against some high frequency antigen or an antibody against the reagent in the panel cells or a cold agglutinin which is reacting in AHG phase. So further investigations, we saw that multiple cross-matches with A red cells were compatible, but not with O group red cells. So the possibility of antibody against high frequency antigen is ruled out because it is unlikely that that antigen is present only with the O cells, but not with the A cells of the donors. And on repeating the IAT with washed panel cells, it was still persisting. And so the antibody against reagent is also ruled out. So we are left with the cold agglutinin, and to identify the specificity of this cold agglutinin, we have tried reacting the sample serum with different types of cells, like the O adult with enzyme treatment, and there was increased grade of reaction. However, it did not react with cord cells, the Bombay phenotype cells, or the A adult cells and the A cord cells. So it was matching the specificity with anti-IH. This is a combined antibody which reacts only in the presence of both I and H antigens, but not when either of it is alone present. So anti-IH is a benign cold agglutinin, but still it is implicated in acute and delayed transfusion reactions. So it is more commonly seen in A1 and A1B individuals as a naturally occurring antibody because of the order of H antigen expression. The H antigen expression is weak in A1 and A1B individuals compared to the O. So we see a higher grade of reaction with O cells, but not with A1 or A1B cells. So this was the cause for blood grouping discrepancy. And though the resolution was done with warm incubation, however, identification of this antibody is important because it might lead to transfusion reactions, acute and delayed transfusion reactions. Moving on to the next case, it was a 6-year-old child admitted to the pediatric ICU followed by a cobra bite. A phagiotomy was planned in view of cellulitis and compartment syndrome of the right leg. Blood grouping request is received and the results are as shown below. The forward was O positive and the reverse, it was looking like A. And the serum grouping was A. So could it be a missing anti-A antibodies in the patient or a missing A antigens? So further, for the confirmation, for missing antibodies, the serum to cell ratio was increased and followed by cold incubation for half an hour. There was a weak reaction observed with A cells, but not in the autocontrol or O cells. So it could be a missing antibody or weak reactions of antibody. The possibility of missing antigens is ruled out in this case because both the parents were of O group and weak B antigens is not possible. So the only significant clinical history in this case was the patient received 50 vials of anti-snake venom during her admission. So to check whether this anti-snake venom has any effect on the antibodies of the patient, we tried reacting O plasma from different donors in the presence of snake venom and without the presence of anti-snake venom. So there was a neutralization of the anti-A present in the serum of the individual, giving a negative reaction with A cells in the presence of snake venom and not in the presence of anti-snake venom. So anti-snake venom is a concentrated preparation of serum globulins, and it is known to cause false positivity during immunohematological testing, but not false negative results. But some constituents of equine-derived anti-snake venom may also act as antigens, which can neutralize the anti-A in these in the plasma. So there was a study conducted in 1952, which has showed that there is presence of A or A-like substances in every specimen of horse serum investigated, but not any B substance was demonstrable. So this could be the possible reason of the missing anti-A in this patient. At the time of discharge, the blood group was repeated and there was no ambiguity identified. So to summarize the serum group discrepancies, they can be either missing or weak or extra antibodies. Missing or weak antibodies are seen mostly in newborns or elderly or in immunocompromised individuals, and in some rare causes like as we have seen when there is solubility because of the anti-snake venom. So to resolve these discrepancies, it is important to know the age, history, medications, and even the antiglobulin testings help in resolution of the discrepancies. So to resolve the missing or weak antibodies, increase the cell to serum ratio, incubation at room temperature and followed by 4°C, and use of enzymes to enhance the antigen antibody reactions can help in increasing the weaker reactions. And for extra antibodies, pre-warming of the samples as in cold autoantibodies or incubation at 37°C can help in resolving the extra antibody discrepancies caused because of extra antibodies. So this is about the serum group discrepancies. Now moving on to the next case, and we'll be covering the forward or the cell grouping discrepancies from now. A newborn sample was received for blood grouping and DAT, and the reports are as shown below. In column agglutination technology, there was a 3+ mixed field in all anti-A, anti-B, and anti-D, and the same in tube technique, it was still AB positive. And the DAT in tube technique was 4+ in this newborn as well. So a mother's antibody screen was performed and it was negative. So the we were possibly thinking of an AB positive newborn with the features of ABOHDN. However, the baby did not have any signs of hemolysis. And when we tried to get the blood group of the mother and father, it was mother was O RHD positive and the baby was B RHD positive. So it is unlikely for the baby to be of AB type. So when we reviewed, the sample was a cord sample received, and we could identify that the newly joined technician has failed to wash the red cells before performing the blood grouping and DAT. So repeat grouping was performed using washed cells, and there was no discrepancy. The blood group was found to be B positive and the DAT was negative. So the possible cause for discrepancy is the Wharton's jelly, which is a viscous polysaccharide causing RBC aggregation. Moving on to the next case, it was a 35-year-old male as a part of routine health check requested for blood grouping. So his forward grouping is O positive and the reverse group, it is B. So we repeated in tube technique, it was still, the discrepancy still persisted. The anti-H lectin is positive. So the possible causes, is it a missing anti-B or missing B antigens? So to resolve the discrepancy, first to rule out the clerical or technical errors, a repeat sample was also requested, and the grouping discrepancy still persisted even with fresh samples. So we were thinking of a subgroup of B. So an adsorption and elution was performed, adsorption with polyclonal anti-B followed by heat elution was performed, and we could identify the B, the polyclonal anti-B was eluted from the donor red cells. So there is some weak expression of B antigen on the red cells, which could be demonstrated only upon adsorption and elution. So the secretor status studies were also done, and they were positive for H and B antigens, confirming the presence of the B subgroup. So further confirmatory testing in such cases can be done by demonstrating the presence of transferases and molecular typing. Yeah. Interpretation of these subgroups is important because if they are mistyped as O and being given to a O recipient, the anti-B in the recipient can cause hemolysis and acute hemolytic transfusion reaction can occur. So it is important to interpret the B subgroups very carefully. So coming to the next case, it is a 54-year-old male patient who was admitted with easy fatigability and low-grade intermittent fever not associated with chills. In view of the low platelet count, which requires a transfusion, we received a request for blood grouping. So the blood grouping was O, forward was O positive, and the reverse, again, there is a missing anti-B. So when we repeated in tube technique, still the discrepancy persisted. There is, and even after incubation at 4 degrees centigrade, there was no enhancement of the reaction. And we also identified that the anti-H lectin is negative in this case, and the anti-AB is negative. So the forward is O and the reverse B. Could it be missing anti-B or a B subgroup or a para-Bombay phenotype? So the increased serum to cell ratio and cold incubation, no change in reactivity pattern. Adsorption and elution with polyclonal anti-H and anti-B was still negative. And the interesting thing here, what we observed was the patient's brother has told that his historic blood group was always B positive, and only from past 2 months he is being reported as ORHD positive. So we performed a secretor study as well, and it showed the presence of B and H antigens. And when we reviewed his lab reports, the hemoglobin was 9 and platelet count was 35 with increased WBC count, and the peripheral smear showed myeloid precursor cells. And during this time, even the bone marrow and flow cytometry confirmed the diagnosis of acute myeloid leukemia. It is at this point that we identified that we are dealing with a case of leukemia-induced decreased antigen expression in the forward grouping. So the causes of this decreased expression: inactivation of the A or B, A, B or H transferases. This is because in myeloid malignancy, there is recurrent deletion of the 9q2331 region. And this might extend till the 9q34 region, leading to the inactivation of these transferases. And also independent silencing at the ABOR FUT1 loci or epigenetic mechanisms can also lead to this decreased gene activity. So it was a clue to the diagnosis of leukemia that since 2 months his antigen expression has been decreased, and without this historic blood group, he would have been mistyped as para-Bombay. Coming to the next case, a 25-year-old male posted for surgery for correction of knee fracture. A type N screen was received at blood bank, and the blood group is as shown below. He was a B and the anti-D was showing a mixed field reaction. And the reverse grouping was B. So what are the possible causes of mixed field reaction in this anti-D? Could it be a B variant? Or is there a history of transfusion or transplantation? So there was a history of transfusion in this patient. And when we reviewed his history, he met with an RTA 2 days prior. And in the emergency, he had received a transfusion of type-specific red blood cells. However, when we reviewed our records, he was a regular donor and his blood group was found to be BRHD positive. So when we performed RCA, we could identify that there was a wrong blood in tube at the emergency triage, where B positive and B negative have of two patients were interchanged, and repeat grouping at the discharge identified to be B RHD positive. If there was no history of transfusion in this case, typing this individual as a D variant would be better, because the certain D variant cases might develop anti-D, and this can cause transfusion reactions in future transfusions. So to summarize the cell grouping discrepancies, they can be either missing or weak, or extra reactions, or mixed field reactions. So the missing or weak antigens can be because of subgroups, leukemias, and the extra reactions may be because of acquired B or Roulet or presence of cold autoantibodies or the Wharton's jelly. So as already discussed, the age, history, diagnosis are very important for resolution of these discrepancies, and increase of cell to serum, incubation at room temperature and 4 degrees, adsorption and elution studies, and the secretar studies will help in diagnosing the missing or weak antigens. And for resolution of these extra reactions in the cell grouping, pre-warming of the sample, incubation at 37 degrees centigrade, use of saline replacement technique in Roulet formation, and warm saline wash to wash out the cold antibodies might help in resolution of the cell grouping discrepancies. To add a small note on the mixed field reactions, this is also called chimerism, where we see a two cell population in a single individual. This can be either inherited or induced, and temporary or permanent. So true chimerism is very rare. It is mostly inherited and permanent, seen mostly in twins, and because of in utero exchange of blood because of vascular anastomosis. If not in twins, it may be because of dyspermy, where two sperms can fertilize one egg, leading to the mosaicism. And more commonly seen is artificial chimerism, which is because of blood transfusions, ABO incompatible transplantations, exchange transfusions, or fetomaternal bleeding. So other commonly read discrepancies include acquired B phenomenon, the BF phenotype, discrepancies because of the blood group soluble substances, polyagglutination, and the CCAB phenotypes. I'll be just briefly describing about these discrepancies. So in acquired B, because of the infections, the bacterial enzymes convert the immunodominant A sugar, that is the N-acetyl D-galactosamine, to D-galactose, leading to the formation of a pseudo-B antigen and weak or mixed field reactions in the forward grouping. So resolution, use of autologous RBCs can be used. The anti-B will not react with the autologous B cells, and reacetylation of these cells using acetic anhydride, or increasing the pH above 8.5 or below 6 of the anti-B reagents, and use of secretar steries and lectin can help in differentiating the acquired B phenomenon. So the blood group soluble substances, these are seen in certain infections, especially in pancreatic carcinoma, etc., where the excess amount of this blood group substances neutralizes the anti-A or anti-B reagents, leading to the missing or weak antigens in the forward grouping. So a clear clinical history will be helpful in resolution, and washing the cells 3 to 6 times will help in removing these soluble substances, and then performing the blood grouping might help in resolution. The cis-AB phenomenon, this is inheritance of both AB genes from one parent and one O gene from the other parent, leading to inheritance of 3 ABO genes instead of 2, leads to the cis-AB phenomenon. Here, since both A and B genes are inherited together and are on the same chromosome, they are termed as cis-AB. They give weakly reactive A or B and B antigens and weak reactions in the forward grouping, and sometimes weak anti-B may also be present. So these are the common other ABO discrepancies which we do not encounter regularly but are being but are important to keep in mind. So to summarize, we can even classify these discrepancies as type 1, 2, 3, and 4 based on the type of reactions. So when there is an unexpected reaction in the serum grouping, like a weak or missing antibodies, it can be classified as type 1. And type 2, when there is unexpected reactions in the cell grouping, weak or missing antigens can be typed as type 2. And protein or plasma abnormalities leading to roulet formation or pseudoagglutination can be typed as type 3. And miscellaneous, because of cold reactive autoantibodies or unexpected ABO isoagglutinins or non-ABO agglutinins are typed as type 4. And to resolve each kind of discrepancy, there are different resolution techniques as mentioned. So to summarize, first, we need to rule out the technical errors, which can include clerical, reagent related, equipment related, or procedural errors. And following ruling out all those errors, then we should type them either as related to antigen related or antibody related discrepancies. Resolving these is important for interpretation, as I have already discussed. So this is the end of the thing. Thank you.
That was a very good presentation, Dr. Deepika. You have very nicely outlined. I think all the people who are listening have commented that it has been a very clear presentation. So congrats to you on that account.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. So she has very nicely outlined how to pick up weak red cell antigens. So when the red cells are less, increase the ratio of the cells to serum. And if you find that there are weaker antibodies which are not being picked up, then increase the ratio of serum to red cells. So, and then, however, one more thing she mentioned about is the increasing the ratio. But there is one Dr. Rani, Dr. Who is that? I forgot. Dr. Rath. Let me see
who that
is.
Huh? Dr. Manish has put up.
Dr. Manish has made a comment, a very interesting comment, that in addition to remembering that their antibodies could be due to a prozone phenomenon, therefore you might need to dilute the serum and also check it. That is probably a good point to note. So any comments from my co-chair before we open it up for further discussion?
Sir, it was very nice presentation.
Yes, please continue.
And she has taken all type of
confirm after the short time. Lebum confirm. AR on Thursday.
We would request all the participants to please mute themselves while the chairperson is speaking.
I will congratulate Dr. Deepika. She has taken very nice cases. In such a short time, she has taken each and every type of cases we should be what we should know, and presented the presentation very nicely and clearly. Thanks, Dr. Deepika.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Deepika. We have one or two questions. I'll just put it up for you. Yeah. One question is, please explain the procedure of secretor studies. I guess it is a lengthy procedure to explain.
Better to share it with her rather than explain it.
Yes, yes. Absolutely. So this can be read up maybe, and we can take the next question. How to rule out Parabombay A positive in case number 6? So maybe we'll have to go back and see.
This again, I think these are questions requiring extensive answers, but using that case, could you like to comment on it, Dr. Deepika? Dr. Deepika? Hello?
Haan, sir.
No.
Yes, sir.
Would you like to elaborate on A Bombay phenotype? Using for that A Bombay phenotype, what you mentioned, your case number
6. Sir, it was related to anti-IH.
Anti-IH, case number 6, probably.
Yes.
Referring to that. So I don't think there was Parabombay A or B phenotypes presented here.
Here there was a weak antigen, weak H antigen expression still present on the red cells. Mm-hmm. So I think
Okay, I think Parabombates are an entirely different topic by itself.
Yeah.
They don't relate to any specific cases here. So rather, let us focus on the cases that we have discussed. Can we come to the first case, Deepika? A2 with anti-A1?
Yes, sir.
So what is the lesson from this A2 with anti? So whenever you have a reaction with A cells, for people who come who have come to transfusion medicine in the early part of their career, it is important to remember that there can be A2 subgroup with an antibody A1. And if it is not A2 with anti-A1, then you need to look for atypical antibodies. Any atypical by doing an antibody screening and identification. But today I have an exactly interesting case. Since there are no questions, I wish to ask Dr. Deepika and others here whether they can help me solve this. I have exactly what you have got. Like, yeah, it seems like A group with antibody A1. The antibody screening is negative. That is negative. But unfortunately, it is not A2. It is A1 only. It is reacting very clearly with A1 antisera. Cross match with A1 cells and A2 cells, both are incompatible. Only O group is compatible. So in this situation, I'm wondering what this group could be.
A positive.
Exactly similar to what you showed, A group with anti-A1.
A positive.
I think one at a time, please. Mr. Prakash Gajja. No, we are getting an echo. Okay, anybody else has a comment?
Sir, it could be a cross-reacting antibody which is present in the anti-serum. Was it checked with different lots of?
Yes, two lots we have checked.
Okay, sir.
But it continues to persist. And in tube technique also, there is no change. The reaction is not weak. It is a +4 reaction.
Okay,
with
sir.
The A cells and B cells.
But not with O cells, sir.
No, not with O cells. Antibody screening by 3-cell panel is also clearly negative. That is negative. Patient has been transfused, but transfused with O cells in November. And again, yesterday we had to give O cells.
Okay, sir.
Because we could not resolve this grouping. So I was just wondering, so the point, now what I wanted to make was there could be something else other than A2 with anti-A1 and an atypical antibody. There may be something else we will know for later. I'm sure we can't resolve such things over a seminar in 2 minutes. So I just wanted to put the idea in case anybody has encountered these things. And another case that seemed very interesting, I'm sure some of you might already know about it, is how snake venom can neutralize A substances or A antigens and give rise to blood group discrepancies. That was very nice, Dr. Deepika.
Yes, that was
really applaud the work done by KMC Manipal. I know it is not easy to go and get snake venom and try it out.
It must have been a very tough job. Shami ma'am's interest in identifying it, sir.
Uh-huh. Is Dr. Shami here? Not there? Is Dr. Shami there in this program? Okay.
I guess not joined, sir.
Yes, anybody has any question? Anything, any comments have come up? No.
There is one more question, sir.
Yes.
The question is how to rule out presence of alloantibody in a cold hemolytic anemia case with recent history of blood transfusion. If alloadsorption cannot be performed as the phenotype of the patient is not known. Dr. Vijaya has asked this question, I guess.
Just come again.
I think that is the only way of identifying an underlying alloantibody when there is a history of blood transfusion. Without alloadsorption, we will not be able to identify any underlying antibody.
Okay.
Yes.
To answer your question, sirs, Dr. Arun has mentioned an answer that it could be an antibody against high frequency antigen, maybe.
Yes.
So that is what he has replied to your question, which was previously asked by you.
Mm-hmm.
But unlikely because O cells are negative.
Yes, yes. All right. The O cells right. are negative. But A1 and A2 are incompatible. Okay, that was only food for thought. We can get along with the questions. Any other?
There are no more questions as such. If anybody is having any questions, they can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Okay, if there are no questions, I think we should thank Dr. Deepika for her very lucid presentation. She has highlighted what is the blood group discrepancy. When cell grouping and serum grouping don't match with each other, we call it a blood group discrepancies. Blood group discrepancies, as you know, can be a nightmare when you need to transfuse blood in an emergency. So and there is zero tolerance in any blood bank with respect to blood groups and wrong blood issues. So it's very important, more important probably than all the NAT testing, the antibody screening and identification, to learn techniques for resolving blood group discrepancies, without which we will look foolish in front of our doctors and patients. So thank you very much, Dr. Deepika, for covering this very important topic in a very nice way. Over to my co-chair.
Madam, please unmute yourself.
Thanks, Deepika. Very nice presentation. Thanks.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
So here we are at the end of the session. We thank our honorable chairpersons, Dr. Sunita ma'am and Dr. Shivram sir, for their valuable time and inputs. We also thank our speaker for the day, Dr. Deepika, for the wonderful informative session. I'm sure all the participants, especially the PG residents, must have benefited from the session, and it will surely help them to approach similar cases properly in a systematic way. And Dr. Deepika, the cases were described really very well. Thank you. We also thank all our participants for their time, and I thank all the YPF Scientific Committee colleagues for their support and cooperation. And the recording of this session will be available soon. Our next session will be next Wednesday, that is 17th February, and it will be free paper sessions. So we shall now conclude this session. Thank you all. Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Yeah.